couple of days ago, I was going through my Facebook statuses and reading the different people that were posting things, and a young man who has had a very, very tough time in his life, he's had a difficult life, and he wrote something on his Facebook status, and he claimed to be a Christian, but went through great tragic events and unbelief and many other things. Suddenly wrote a status recently, and he said the following. He said, "I do not believe that Jesus is God. I do not believe in the concept of the Trinity. Because if Jesus was God, then how do you describe that when Jesus was praying in his great high priestly prayer," I'm just using this as an example, "that God was praying to himself. And I have converted to becoming a Muslim." Well, now this is a very, very popular thing in these days where people are denying and renouncing their faith. It seems almost hip to do it on Facebook. The problem is these guys who start off maybe well or start off with a bang always land up apostatizing or turning away from the faith. And because they don't know the word of God. The biggest problem and the biggest ill today in the Church of Jesus Christ is the lack of knowledge of the doctrines of the word of God. And I want to deal with the subject of the Trinity, the divine, holy, thrice holy God. I want to deal with the subject because there is a tremendous amount of confusion with regards to the subject. And if you read the Bible very closely and you read it clearly, you will discover that much of the confusion goes when a person begins to read the Word of God with care. The Word of God needs to be read with care, beloved. We can't just manufacture doctrines out of the Bible. Too many people are busy doing that. Read this verse, and this is what this verse means, and giving our own private interpretation. No, we need to understand the context. We need to understand the theological backdrop. We need to understand biblical doctrine and theology. Well, I don't like theology. Well, unfortunately, the Bible is nothing more than Holy Ghost theology given to man. That's what the Word of God is. And therefore, we need to understand the truths of God's Word. And unfortunately, most Christians today, even those that have been saved for about 30, 40 years, do not understand the first thing about the Trinity or any doctrine for that matter. And it's a very, very sad state of affairs because the Bible is filled with these high and holy teachings that can really get us into some beautiful places in the Lord where we can come to understand and have a greater understanding of who the Lord Jesus Christ actually is. And the Trinity is one of the most vital, and it is one of the most important subjects. It is the very foundation of Christianity, where it's out of the very doctrine of the Trinity that our salvation comes. How we are saved. We have to have that in our minds when dealing with this particular subject. So I want to start off by reading the good old King James Version. Reading verse chapter 5 of 1 John. 1 John chapter 5. Reading from verses 7, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one." This is one of the major Trinitarian proof texts. If you've been following in your Bible and you've got an NASB, or you have got a NIV, or you have got a RSV, or one of these modern translations. Funny enough, the Amplified doesn't take it out, nor does the Dewey translation, the old Latin Vulgate. But modern translations take this verse of scripture out. And it is the Trinitarian proof text because the Trinity is spoken of in absolute clear form. The arguments of these modern theologians concerning this particular verse, why they removed it, is because apparently Erasmus added it. Where's the evidence for that? They just spout off nonsense as nonsense so chooses. But this is a Trinitarian proof text, but I want to say something. It's very like John in his book. The very things that he says here, it doesn't break the whole unity of the chapter of chapter 5, it just exemplifies a truth that John has been proclaiming even in his gospel. And they want to tell me it's not in there. Well, I believe it was written there in the originals, and I believe that this scripture has been tampered with by wicked men, unholy hands on the Bible, because you have many people who are Bible editors, who are Unitarians or Jehovah's Witnesses, and they have a problem with certain doctrines, and they tamper with the Word of God. And this is a very, very big problem in the area of textual criticism. And I have a problem with this. I do not like or believe that born-again Christians, that non-Christians need to tamper with the Greek text, because the Greek text is the inspired Word of God, and therefore they can add whatever they want. You find that in the Jehovah's Witness Bible, which I have a copy of. They tamper with these major Bible doctrines. And here is a major Bible doctrine where it says there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. This term oneness is literally spoken of continuously in the Gospel of John and is done repeatedly. Let me repeat that. This term oneness is spoken of in the Gospel of John, and it is spoken of repeatedly. It is a term that is found in Johannine theology. This term oneness. There are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. It complements the Gospel of John, this verse. It actually says exactly what the Holy Spirit says. It is the Word of God, and we cannot say we don't believe it was in the originals, because it matches the very things that John wrote in his book. It matches it. So I don't know where these people get off in saying that it's not in the originals, but according to them, it was added. That's their opinion. And as our wonderful Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones once said, he said, never trust the scholars. The scholars have problems. Read them, but don't trust them. Have a distrust for scholarship. And he wrote that in his excellent book called What is an Evangelical? Well, let's look at this particular thing that we've just seen over here in 1 John chapter 5, and go over to the book of John, the first chapter and the first verse. John, the first chapter and the first verse. And the Holy Spirit says, in the beginning was the Word, the Logos, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Kenneth Copeland, one of the leading charismatic heretics of today, who is a Word of Faith teacher, who teaches all the Word of Faith garbage, name it, claim it, blab it, grab it, and a whole bunch of other things, who is a multi-billionaire, has gone on record saying that Jesus, when he came to earth, he did not come to earth as God. He came as man, and in fact, he goes on to say that the Lord Jesus Christ never in his earthly walk claimed to be God. He said, go and search the scriptures, and you will find that Jesus never claimed to be God. Well, right there in John 1:1, the scriptures is telling me that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Kenneth Copeland is either a fool, or he's an out-and-outright liar, or an out-and-outright antichrist, which he is. That's what he is, essentially. He is denying fundamental Bible truth that is already revealed in the Bible. So I will go to the Word of God, and I will show you repeatedly from the scriptures that Jesus himself claimed to be God. Let me give you one very, very big scripture over here. We'll come back to John 1:1, John the 8th chapter. John the 8th chapter. John the 8th chapter. Jesus said unto them in verses 58, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Remember Moses and that burning bush? What did the angel of the covenant, the second middle pillar of the Godhead, who was the Lord Jesus Christ, speaking to him, say? I am that I am, hath sent me to thee. That's what you tell the children of Israel, he told Moses. I am that I am. Eternal, pre-existent, never having a beginning and never having an end. The I am is revealing himself to Moses in Exodus chapter 3. I am that I am, the eternal pre-existent one. And that's exactly what John 1:1 says. I am that I am. Now, a very interesting characteristic about the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John, you find that there is a satanic movement against Jesus that is continuously exemplified throughout this gospel. There is a lot of conflict in the Gospel of John. How did I get that? Well, I've just read the Gospel of John, and I've seen that the Gospel of John reveals to me that there is a tremendous conflict with Jesus, the Son of God, with the religious rulers, with the publicans and the sinners, and mostly with the religious rulers of his day, who had a problem with his claims. Now, after Jesus says here in the book of John 8:44, before Abraham was, I am, they take up stones to stone him. That's not the first time. There's a time before that where they take up stones to stone him. What did they take up stones to stone him on? Well, they wanted to stone him because he claimed to be God. Kenneth Copeland claims that Jesus never claimed to be God, but that is the very thing and the very reason why the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified, was because of his claims to being God. That is why Jesus, our Messiah, was crucified, because he claimed eternal godhood and eternal oneness with the Father. The time before that, it was when Jesus literally said, destroy this temple in 3 days and I will raise it up. The Jews got as mad as snakes at him, and they took up stones to stone him again. They wanted to kill him. Over 4 times in the Gospel of John, you find that these religious rulers wanted to kill Jesus over his statements concerning his godhood. This was the problems that the Jewish people had, because they understood completely what the term Son of God meant. That Son of God is a reference to the Lord Jesus Christ's divinity, and it's a reference to his deity. That he is the Son of the living God, that he is eternal, that he is co-equal, that he was literally claiming to be the I am man and the God man walking in the flesh. That is what he was claiming to be. And it was on this particular subject and this particular teaching that Jesus was trying to get to the Jews and the whole world that they crucified the Lord Jesus Christ because of these statements. He got them as mad as a snake time and time again when he claimed to be God. And unfortunately, the Gospel of John is a polemic that literally teaches us concerning the Lord Jesus Christ's godhood, or the godhood of the eternal Son. Right in those opening verses, before Abraham was, I am. But something very interesting about the Gospel of John, you don't just find this term, I am here, Yahweh, mentioned here in the 54th verse of the 8th chapter. You find it repeatedly throughout the Gospel of John. Let me give you an example. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. I am, I am, I am. I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection. I am the life. I am, I am. I'm the good shepherd of the sheep. Jesus, throughout this gospel, more than any other place, speaks of himself as Yahweh. He calls himself the I am. Just go and have a look. Copeland is wrong. Copeland says, oh yes, Jesus never claimed to be God. He never claimed to be God on the earth. He just claimed that he walked with God and was some divinely empowered man. Well, unfortunately, through what I have just said in the opening of this teaching, Jesus declared himself to be God. Who's wrong? Me or Kenneth Copeland? Who's wrong? The Lord Jesus Christ or John? Well, according to Kenneth Copeland, John, me, and the Lord Jesus Christ is wrong. Well, I'm afraid we are not wrong, because the New Testament repeatedly emphasizes the very doctrine of Jesus' divinity, that he was God manifested in the flesh, that he is God-man. Let's just look at another scripture, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16. Now, if you've got a modern translation, I will correct what it says there, but follow me in your Bibles, whether you have a modern translation or not. 1 Timothy, that's Thessalonians. We want to go to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. The Lord Jesus Christ was God manifested in the flesh, and he said as much, that he was God manifested in the flesh. Great is that mystery. It is a mystery. There are actually two mysteries revealed in the Bible. One is the mystery of godliness, which is the doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the other is the mystery of iniquity, which is the mystery of Antichrist, the spirit of Antichrist, and the Antichrist that should come. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. Jesus is God manifested in the flesh. And Jesus, as Paul writes in Romans, is God blessed forever. If anybody denies this essential teaching, he is going against the very teaching of the holy apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is going against the word of God. And what is that? When people begin to deny something that is right in your Bible. I just want to say something over here. That word over there, God, was manifested in the flesh in 1 Timothy 3:16, is removed from modern translations again. They say, he who was manifested in the flesh. No, it's God. The Hebrew word, the Greek word is God. And they say he. It's again because the editors of these modern versions and these modern translations have a problem with certain doctrines with regards to the godhood of the eternal Son. God was manifested in the flesh. He is fully God and he is fully man. He is the God-man. The Lord Jesus Christ is the God-man. God the Son, the man-God. And we worship him, the one who is seated at the right hand of God the Father, as the God-man. It's very, very clear when you understand scriptures that Jesus is God, and he claimed to be God. It was on that profession that they wanted to kill him. The eternal pre-existent one, what he was literally saying before Abraham was, I am, and his other statements like, I am the vine, I am the branches, I am, I am, I am. He's literally saying, I was even there before Abraham. I'm the pre-existent one. Before Abraham ever stood, I'm pre-existent. I'm one with the Heavenly Father. He is the pre-existent Lord Jesus Christ that has always existed until he came into time and eternity and the Word became flesh and tabernacled amongst us. He is the eternal second person of the Trinity. And this is the doctrine of the Word of God. This is what the Bible teaches us. Any denial of that is heresy. Any denial of that is the spirit of Antichrist. And we need to understand what Antichrist is. Antichrist is in opposition to the Lord Jesus Christ, or in the place of Christ. Anything that will oppose the doctrines of the Lord Jesus Christ. Anything that will look at a version like the King James Version and say, well, I don't like the teaching of the Godhood of the Eternal Son. I don't like what it says. I want to get rid of those particular scriptures. You are in opposition to the words of the Holy Spirit, because the words of the Holy Spirit have already revealed, and God has already revealed himself, that he is the I Am, the eternal pre-existent one, the Lord Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity. That is who he is. God the Son, the man God. These are the very attributes of the Lord Jesus Christ, the eternal pre-existent one. Well, let's go on. Let's go on. Repeatedly in the Gospel of John, they wanted to stone him for this blasphemy of calling himself God, because they understood, the Jews, that Son of God is actually a term that denotes the Lord Jesus Christ's divinity. He was claiming to be one with the Heavenly Father. Well, let's just go back over there to the book of John, chapter 1. There is so much in this Gospel. I really wish people would read their Bibles and get a delight to read the Word of God, because much of our spiritual problems come out of our lack of understanding. And whenever you come to scriptures, and especially what we're dealing with, you should be praying and saying, Lord, as Paul wrote in the book of Ephesians chapter 1, that the eyes of your understanding might be enlightened, that you might know the hope of his calling and the glorious inheritance of the saints in light, that the eyes of your understanding might be enlightened. The biggest problem is, in this modern generation, it is that our eyes and our understandings are not enlightened to the truth. And then you've got those beautiful scriptures there in the book of Psalms 119, which we should pray. Quicken thou me according to thy word. Quicken thou me according to thy loving kindness. Quicken thou me in thy way. Quicken thou me in thy righteousness. Quicken thou me in thy justice. We need to be quickened. We need to ask the Holy Spirit to quicken these truths to us, because they are living truths that the Holy Spirit has put in the Word of God. Well, let's go on. Let's go back to John 1:1. We can be on it for hours. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Notice the very first thing the Holy Spirit says. In the beginning, the Word was with God. With God. Go down to verses 17. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which was in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. The Word was with God. Notice the Holy Spirit does not contradict what he said in previous verses. He says that the Lord Jesus Christ was in the bosom of his Father, the intimate dwelling place of the Father. The Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father and God the Holy Spirit shared an intimacy that you and I would envy. That is why in the book of John, further on, another time when they wanted to stone the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus said, I and my Father are one. I and my Father are one. And in fact, he continuously, throughout this beautiful book of John, exalts in the oneness. Now, it's not the digit one. It is talking about one in three and three in one, how precious it is for the brethren to dwell in unity. It's talking, it's a Hebrew concept. It comes directly out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4, where it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. It's not the digit, it is oneness. I remember about a year ago, a young man who knows very, very little about the Word of God, and he's a preacher in England. I knew him, but he's a preacher. He's a charismatic preacher. Told me in a personal message that he knows nothing. He knows the barest knowledge of biblical truth, and he's standing on a pulpit busy preaching to people, empty barrel, making a lot of noise, preaching stuff that he doesn't even know the barest knowledge of doctrine. And he's going to teach these people the Word of God. He's going to teach them something. And he said to me that he's been called to go and preach to the Muslims in Arabia. And nothing's going to stop him from fulfilling his calling of what God's called him to do. So I asked this young man, I said, Tim, can I ask you a question? He said, sure. I said, what are you going to do when you meet a Muslim theologian and the Muslim theologian quotes you Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. This was a thing that I was, when I was very, very young, I didn't know much. I was saved, but I didn't know much. And I was working in Clicks and Cresta, and this was in the 1990s, and I started chatting to a Muslim, and that is the verse of scripture that he used. I didn't know how to counteract him. I was ignorant. I didn't know the Word of God. And ignorance is not bliss when it comes to the spiritual realm. So I couldn't answer him a biblical thing. Maybe today I'd be able to answer him more clearly that term oneness, it's not one, the digit one, it is oneness. It corresponds to let us make man in our image and our likeness, Genesis 1:26, let us. And I asked him the question, what are you going to do when they ask you that particular question? Do you know this young charismatic man could not answer me one word about it? He came back with a voice note on WhatsApp saying, oh, well, you know, I'm going to about how these people saw visions of Jesus, and that's what I'll do. And he gave this long thing of what he was going to do. Now, the problem is with this young man is he's not called to minister the word. If you are called to minister the word, the Lord will equip you. He will equip you to do that particular work. But this guy doesn't know the Bible. He doesn't understand the Bible. He doesn't understand the first thing of theology. And I know he's a caregiver. What he should do is be a comforter and minister love to the people that he's caregiving to. But he's not a minister. He's not meant to be in the pulpit. He doesn't understand biblical truth. He doesn't understand theology. He doesn't understand doctrine. He's an ignoramus. Sorry and all that jazz. That is what this young man is. And he's teaching deception because he doesn't understand the gospel. But, oh, God called him. Well, if God calls you, he's going to equip you to give you an understanding of this truth that you're going to be able to minister to people and impart life into them. He will give you an understanding. God's not making a group of morons be more moronic. He's not putting morons in the place of authority. This is something the charismatic movement has no understanding concerning. God is not putting morons in the place of spiritual authority to lead people. He's not doing that. It's actually Satan that is raising these men up who don't know the Bible. These people are satanic, according to the Bible, as of the spirit of Antichrist. Now, Lucifer says, it says, the word was with God, that with Godness. The word was with God. Turn with me to the book of John 17, the great high priestly prayer. John chapter 17. This is an idea that is continuously emphasized throughout the Gospel of John. I could give you scripture after scripture concerning this, but I'm just giving you this one at the moment. John chapter 17. And it says, I am glorified in them, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come unto thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. And it speaks about the love further on that Jesus himself had to the Father before the world began. They had a love relationship that you and I would envy. This love relationship between the Father and Son. And he's praying for the same oneness that we might experience, the same oneness that he himself experienced in the triune Godhead in that relationship. He is praying for that oneness. And by the way, that oneness is not some ethereal, mystical thing. Yes, in a sense, it has got that sense to it, but it's actually talking about oneness on Bible truth and doctrine. It's talking about being one on the fact that we agree on the truths concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. And he goes on later and he says that he speaks in the most beautiful terms of how the Father loved him. Neither I pray for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may all be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, they may also be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me I gave them, that they may be one even as we are one. There's that love relationship between the Father and the Son, this unity and this communion that the Godhead shared from eternity past. And he's praying that we might come to understand that unity of the Lord Jesus Christ with his Father. And these are vital truths. And if you are a charismatic and you're listening to me, sorry and all that jazz, 99.9% charismatics today, and I'm a Pentecostal, I'm a biblical Pentecostal, do not know the word of God. I'm sorry to have to say. There are empty barrels making a lot of noise. They stand up on pulpit saying, I've got something on my heart. And when you investigate it, they've got very, very little on their brains. They are morons teaching other morons how to be morons. The Greek word is idiotus. They are idiots. That's what they are. Kenneth Copeland is an idiot. Joyce Meyer is an idiot. Not to mention the heresy they're busy promoting. They are idiots according to the word of God. They don't have the barest knowledge of biblical truth. They twist the scriptures like Satan. That's what they do because Jesus is God. There are declarations of him being God right throughout the New Testament and especially in the Gospel of John and in the Old Testament. But the problem is this modern generation doesn't like theology and they don't like doctrine and therefore the truths of God's word have been lost to this generation. I and my Father are oneness. corresponding to Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. In fact, I will go as far as to say it was the Lord Jesus Christ himself that gave the law to Moses. It was Jesus Christ himself, the second middle pillar of the Godhead, the second person of the Trinity that gave the teaching to Moses and the law and the prophets. It was the Lord Jesus Christ speaking to them. I and my Father are oneness. Now, these are biblical truths. These are truths that need to be upheld. In another place in the Gospel of John, he actually says, I came forth from my Father. I came out from the intimate dwelling place of my Father. Let me give you another very interesting scripture that is found in the book of John chapter 3. The book of John chapter 3, the most amazing scripture. I haven't heard anybody deal with it. But it's one of the most amazing scriptures if you actually look at it. John the 3rd chapter. And this is what it says. John chapter 3. John, the 3rd chapter, if I can find it in this Bible. Yeah, I found it. The great chapter of ye must be born again. Read on, you'll find some very interesting things. For God so loved the world, as we well know. Here it is in verses 13. And no man, listen to these words, dynamic words, and no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. That is one of those amazing statements out of the very lips of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's as amazing as when Jesus turned around and said, destroy this temple in 3 days and I will raise it up. Most amazing statement. It's an amazing statement. He's talking about himself being on earth, but at the same time in heaven. In other words, Jesus, while he was walking this earth, was in unbroken communion with the Heavenly Father. He was in heaven, sitting there in intimacy with the Father while he was on earth. He was in two places at one time. That's exactly what the Bible says. The Son of Man, which is now in heaven, while he's busy talking to Nicodemus. The Son of Man, which is in heaven. What a dynamic thought. That here the Lord Jesus Christ is on earth, but he's just in unbroken communion with the Father in the heavenly places. Oh my, that's glorious. Oh my, that's stupendous. Oh my, that's mind-blowing. That while he was busy talking to Nicodemus, he was in heaven communicating with the Heavenly Father, having a direct line to heaven. And in this fellowship that he experienced and had with the Father from the foundation of the world, this is absolutely stupendous. It's one of the most glorious things to think about. Meditate on this sometime. The Son of Man, which is in heaven. He's in heaven. In unbroken communion with the Heavenly Father. A direct hotline to heaven, speaking his very words, because he's the very Son of the living God that came forth from the Father, from the triune Godhead. Jesus Christ came. He came forth. He was manifested, brought forth from the Father. Eternal, pre-existent, the second person of the Trinity. He came to this earth. From the Father. Now, notice it says the Word was with God. What does this indicate? Notice the prayer for the unity of the saints and also the unity of the Trinity that he is praying about, that he always had with the Father, the oneness that he had with the Father from the beginning of time. Now, some people have the idea that when it comes to the matter of the Trinity, that God the Father does his own thing, and God the Son does his own thing, and God the Holy Spirit does his own thing. God the Father does something, God the Son does something, and God the Holy Spirit does something. And you will find that many preachers believe, and they teach contradictions between the three persons of the Godhead. Notice that Jesus said he is one. He cannot do anything but what he sees his Father do. He is one with the Father, one in purpose. He came to finish the work that God gave him to do. I have finished the work which God gave me to do. That's what he prayed in his high priestly prayer. He finished the work. So in other words, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit work in union together in this glorious and marvelous scheme of redemption. If that scheme was not formulated before the world began, you and I would not be saved. Because salvation is not just a mere belief. It has been predetermined by God himself. It has literally been predetermined in the very mind of God himself from the very foundation of the world. Salvation is of the Lord. It is majestic. It is glorious. It is God who conceived our great salvation from the foundation of the world. And the Bible teaches us continuously, especially in the book of Ephesians. The great Puritan divines and the great Reformed Calvinists of the 16th century like to speak of the economic trinity of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit working together in this grand and glorious scheme of redemption. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, the divine three in one. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come. This glorious scheme of redemption. Let's put it this way. God the Father planned our salvation at the very foundation of the world. He planned that salvation, not leaving a stone unturned. Because God is love, and he knew Satan would fall and take one-third of the angel, or how many, of two-thirds of the stars or the angels with him, that he would need to do something with regards to our redemption. God planned this redemption. Because God could have destroyed this whole place when Adam sinned. But because God is love, for God so loved the world that he gave. And he did this from the very foundation of the world. The Bible speaks of Jesus being crucified from the very foundation of the world. Marvelous truths that born-again Christians don't talk about anymore. Our old holy forefathers, like the Puritan divines, used to talk about it. Wesley used to talk about it. The great scheme of redemption, that God himself planned our redemption out from the very foundation of the world. God the Father is the author of our salvation. And I say that reverently. It doesn't begin with the Lord Jesus Christ. It begins with God the Father. What happened was, right at the very beginning of time, whenever this was, in the eternal councils, at this council, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit sat together in a conference. And God the Father presented the plan. The book of Psalms actually speaks of the Lord Jesus Christ covenanting with the Father with regards to this plan. And God the Father, and in this Trinity and in this oneness and this loving Trinity, he organized this plan of redemption, put the plan into motion. He's the originator of the plan of redemption. Right from the very foundation of the world, God the Father planned your and my redemption. And he committed the judgment of that redemption to one divine person of the Godhood only. And that is the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ was given the exclusive job to redeem us. And whenever you see the Lord Jesus Christ, either as a Christophany, as the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament, which is not a angel, it is a definite article, it's Yahweh, you see him always working as a redeemer. And if you read him over there in the book of Exodus chapter 3, the Lord Jesus Christ sounds very, very much like the one who speaks in the book of John. It's the same person, except it's in a spirit form. He's actually Jesus in his pre-incarnate state, before he was incarnated in the flesh. It's the exact same person. So God the Father, in eternity past, gave the job of salvation exclusively to the Lord Jesus Christ right from the very beginning. And that is why Jesus said, I came to do not my own work, but the will of him that sent me. Here you've got that union between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. All working together towards a common goal. And God the Father presented the plan to the Son. And the Son said, I will agree. I will come down in the fullness of time. And I will die for fallen Adam's race of sin to bring many back to God. I will shed my blood. I will go through hell on earth. I will become incarnate. I will even battle the devil in his very own backyard in order to defeat him. And the Holy Spirit, who is the third person of the Trinity, he's not an it. He is a person. As much as God the Father is a person, as much as God the Son is a person, so the Holy Spirit is a divine person. And he is God. He is worshipped within the Trinity. He said, I will go after you raise yourself up from the dead, and we raise you up from the dead together, and I will send the truth concerning, and I will testify concerning you, the Lord Jesus Christ. You see that unity? God the Father plans the redemption. God the Son executes the redemption. And God the Holy Spirit applies the redemption. There's a glorious unity spoken of right throughout the Old and New Testaments concerning God the Father working, God the Son working, and God the Holy Spirit working. Now, I think I'm going to stop there. I think there's much in this particular teaching to get you to meditate and to think on these glorious truths. And may I just pray that the Lord will make them real to your heart. And Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you that you'll quicken us according to your word and according to your understanding. We bless you, wonderful Jesus, for what you have done in our lives. We thank you for our salvation, which was pre-planned before the world began. We thank you that you are one, Lord Jesus, with the Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are God. You are God the Son, eternal. You are God-man. You are Lord. You are King of Kings. We thank you for what you have done in our lives, and we thank you that you will help us in the coming days to understand thy holy truth. And we bless and honor thy holy name forever, because you are Lord. God bless you.